Hi and welcome! If you are into vintage PC hardware of the late 80s or early 90s, you have most probably had to replace one of these leaky barrel batteries. If you are lucky enough, like I was with this motherboard, the battery won't have leaked too much and your motherboard works fine. If not, then repairing the damage can be a challenge. Regardless, once your board is up and running again, you need to decide what to replace the battery with. There are many solutions to this, like replacing it with a new barrel battery, or using an external battery pack with AAA batteries. But what I prefer is using a CR2032 coin cell battery with a diode in series, as these are known not to leak. Mounting the CR2032 on the board can be tricky, which is why I designed the Barrel Battery Blaster, a PCB which makes the process a lot easier. I made a video about this some time ago, so feel free to check it out if you're interested. One downside of using a CR2032 is that, unlike the original barrel battery, it is not rechargeable. But since the clock chip consumes so little power, it doesn't really matter because the battery lasts for a long time. Nevertheless, having something that is rechargeable sounds like a better solution. Recently, I came across this 5V 1F Super Capacitor, which looked particularly interesting. It comes in this nice form factor, which has a pin pitch similar to that of the barrel battery. So I was wondering whether I could use such a supercapacitor as a drop-in replacement. The polarity is etched on the leads, so this side is negative and this side is positive. Okay, let's try it on the motherboard. Yeah, it fits perfectly. Let's solder it on the board. Now let's track its voltage using the multimeter. Let's power the system on. Okay, this took more than 25 minutes, but the voltage is now more than 5 volts and keeps increasing, but the capacitor is rated at 5.0 volts, so it will get damaged. So I decided to turn the system off. I wasn't expecting that the CMOS battery charger would charge the battery to more than 5 volts. Most barrel batteries operate at 3.6 volts. So I assumed that the charging circuit would not go above 5 volts. But I guess I was wrong. The supercapacitor is definitely not a drop-in replacement. Let's check the voltage with the supercapacitor removed. Wow, it is at 9.7 volts. This is open circuit voltage, but still, I was expecting a much lower value. I had a closer look to figure out what the charging circuit was. And yeah, it is a very simple circuit consisting of a Zener diode, a 1K resistor and a diode. So nothing fancy, the circuit would constantly trickle charge the battery with a couple milliamps. This is fine for the rechargeable barrel batteries, but won't work with our supercapacitor. The circuit is using a 4.3 volt Zener diode, so the open circuit voltage at the battery is at 12 volts minus 4.3 volts minus 0.7, which is 7 volts. For our 5 volt supercapacitor, we need a Zener diode with a larger voltage drop. A 6.2 volt Zener gives us 5.1 volts, which is not very safe as the 12 volt rail might be a bit higher than 12 volts. Mine is at 12.2 volts, which would raise the voltage to 5.3 volts. A 6.8 volt Zener gives us 4.5 volts, which is probably the best value to use. But I don't actually have a 6.8 volt Zener, so the next best option is not to use the 12 volt rail, but instead use the 5 volt rail. To connect to 5 volts safely, we need to remove the Zener diode. The result is 5 volts minus the 0.7 voltage drop on the diode, which is 4.3 volts at the capacitor. Okay, this looks good. So what happens when the system is off? Well, the 5 volt rail is now basically ground. So the supercapacitor will try to force current through the diode in reverse, as shown by the arrow. This current that flows through the diode in reverse is called leakage current, and is really low, about 5 microamps. But the supercapacitor has a much lower capacity than a typical battery, so this could be too much. Well, the 5V 1F capacitor holds a charge of 5 coulombs, which is equivalent to a current of 5 amps for 1 second, which is 1.38 milliamp hours, or roughly 1 milliamp hour. A 5 microamp current will drain the capacitor in 200 hours, or about 8 days. This is not great. How about the timer IC? Well, that depends on the actual chip, but according to one datasheet that I had a look at, it consumes about 0.5 microamps, So, with that alone, the supercapacitor can last 10 times as much, or roughly 2.7 months, which I think is acceptable. So the bottleneck is the diode's leakage current, so we need a way to improve it. It turns out that there is a simple way to get orders of magnitude smaller leakage current using an NPN transistor. According to some information I found online, the base emitter reverse leakage of a general purpose NPN transistor is measured in picoamps. Perfect! Okay, let's modify the circuit on the motherboard. The components are these ones here. I'm trying to remove both diodes by pushing the leads with the soldering iron. Now we can pull them from the top. Let's shape the transistor leads such that they fit. I'm shorting the collector and base to add some structural strength. I'm not sure if that will increase the leakage current. If it does, I will cut the collector lead off. Now let's connect the circuit to the 5V rail. We can get 5 volts from pin B3 of the ISA bus. Now that the circuit is ready, let's check the open circuit voltage at the battery pad. And yeah, it is at 4.38 volts, which is exactly what we expect. Okay, now let's add the supercapacitor. Let's power the system on. Okay, so after about an hour, we reached 4.1 volts. About 2 hours later, the voltage has stabilized at 4.2 volts. I just realized that I had connected the transistor wrong. I was using the base collector diode, not the base emitter. Base emitter should have lower reverse leakage than base collector. I fixed this and I also reduced the resistor to 100 ohms for faster charging. 1 hour after turning the system off, the voltage has dropped to 3.99 volts, down from 4.15 volts. This is a huge drop. After a brief search online, it turns out that the supercapacitors have a very high self-discharge current. At this rate, the capacitor will lose all its charge within a couple of hours. Luckily, the self-discharge rate dropped significantly. 24 hours later, I checked again and the voltage had reduced to just under 3 volts. 4 days later, it was at 2.66 volts. The discharge rate seems to be slowing down very significantly as the voltage drops to less than 10 millivolts per day. This suggests that with a different circuit, we may actually get a charge that lasts several weeks. I am currently experimenting with other supercapacitor circuits, so please stay tuned for a future video if you're interested. Okay, so to summarize, there are a couple of downsides with using this 5V coin cell supercapacitor. First, it is not a drop-in replacement. It needs changes on the motherboard components, which may not be desirable or may not be straightforward. Second, it has a very high self-discharge current, so it's not great if you're not using the system very often. And finally, given that these are not widely tested over the years, there is a chance that they actually leak. Okay, that's all for today. I will be doing some further testing, and I will be trying out some alternative supercapacitor circuits, so stay tuned for a future update. I hope you enjoyed the video, and as always, thank you for watching and goodbye.